Chapter 11 of The Crippled God. Things keep getting better. This book is so good so far. So, first thing we get coming right out of the gate in this chapter, we get a look back at Gennabacus. It's very brief, and I actually thought this was going to signal sort of a whole narrative movement with what was happening at Coral, but we don't really get that. We get a brief perspective shot, basically, of Spindle, that this is post everything that happened in Toll the Hounds. There's no more darkness in Black Coral, but then suddenly a lot of ravens show up and it seems like the Tistandi are back or something is happening. So I don't know if that's a reference to what is happening in Carcanas with the Sheik. We also haven't been back there since the breach happened. This is definitely a hint of something to come, but it was just that, a hint. So I'm going to move on and talk about other things in the chapter. The rest of the chapter revolves around the bone hunters in the Glass Desert and various conversations and the basic logistics of how that is looking. As usual, it's very interesting to see their perspective after seeing from the last chapter the perspective of the Greyhelms as well as Queen of the Balkandos. I always forget her name. Aberstall. They looked at the Bone Hunters in this like very sad, morose way. And then we get all of these viewpoints from the Bone Hunters, and just as they have been throughout the series as a whole, they're all very comedic. They have this lightness of speaking about even the hard situation they're in, like they're laughing and joking about the piss they have to drink. Who's at Bottle, who says if he has to drink piss, he wants it to be women's piss so he can pretend it's like something sexual. Like, so they're joking and laughing even in the midst of this terrible peril. And obviously every once in a while it shines through, this awful peril that they're in, but for the most part they're dealing with it like soldiers have to deal with things. The first conversation we have is the Fists meeting with the Adjunct again, and a very interesting clash between Kindly and the Adjunct. Kindly wanting the Adjunct to be more sort of like inspirational in how she's leading, and Tavor's point back, which I actually think, interestingly, is not communicated well by her, but by others around her, saying, no, we're not going to lead by violence, we're going to lead by compassion. And I think that's a great idea, and I wish Tavor personified that a little more. I think right now in the story, she's really just having to be almost emotionless, and like nothing is going to get by her. As is said later in the chapter, she is purposely sort of standing off to the side, but that makes it hard to really like grasp onto her as a leader. And I think that's of course the point, but it is narratively frustrating. I think the point really being that all of these people have to grasp this good cause together for it to truly be that good cause. The choice of having our heroes who we love so much on the side of the Crippled God after everything that we've read in these 10 books is challenging, and it's meant to be challenging, right? Because it's supposed to bring an end to this cycle of pain and viciousness, right? The whole thing about the Crippled God is that he is the fallen one. He has been wronged because he was brought to earth, right? And destroyed by things outside of his control. And so he has thrown that pain and anger on others and caused great suffering. And so to bring an end to this whole thing, it cannot be violence against that which caused the violence. It has to be a larger work of compassion. And that's the whole point of this, and this tension between Kindly and the Adjunct, and then the discussion between all the Fists reflect that, I think, in a really cool way. Then we get this really great sequence. Erickson has used this technique before when he's following large military armies. He basically will, during like a march or in a particular moment in time, he will just take a large section, I mean this is like 40 pages of the book, to just sort of jump in and out of a bunch of different conversations that are happening throughout different units, different pairings, to get a idea of sort of the whole army, right? So we start off with the Fists and the Adjunct, but then we go through sergeants and captains and kind of go all over the army to get sort of a temperature read of how everyone's doing, and to make us obviously care about the unit as a whole, not just individual characters in the middle of it. So they're marching at night through the glass desert, and I, being a big fan of cinema, like envision this as this really cool single shot of the camera always moving slowly, but just a little faster than everyone who's walking. And like people are walking that way and the camera's just showing this way, but moving away from the people. And so we're hearing little bits of conversation, and then slowly as we continue on, we are into another conversation. That just happens over and over and over again, where we're reading about all these people, and then we're reading about the people who are in front of them in the line, and then the people in front of them, and then the people in front of them. And it's just like this single shot of all these conversations, and each one is interesting and valuable and like makes us as the reader care about these individuals. In the midst of this, I think there are two sort of meta moments that are worth reflecting on. I'm going to make a video soon, because there's so much I want to say on this issue about Malazan as a whole being a postmodern, post-structuralist critique on the genre of fantasy in a really powerful way. And I think two specific things in here made me think of this. This conversation between Corporal Clasp and Salt Lick. I'm just going to read this really quickly. So Clasp, we haven't really met before. She's talking to Salt Lick. Sergeant Herb, you and him are the same. You don't say anything. You don't give yourself away. You know, we all know there was a kind of elite group. Squads and a few heavies. Somehow all closer to Fiddler back when he was a sergeant. Closer than the rest of us. We knew it. We could see it. Fiddler and round him, Gessler and Stormy, Balm and Hellion, Cord and Shard, and Herb, with Quickbend dropping in, and then Hedge. And finally some of you heavies, Shortnose, Mayfly, Flashwit. You. I know it. It was all about Fiddler and the ones he drew in around him, the ones he picked. And so they have this whole conversation about being the ones in the know. And then later on she says, look at my soldiers, look at Sad. You know who she is? A little bit later. You'll see for yourself, assuming we survive this desert. Then there's Burnt Rope, a sapper. Later on, we see Lap Twirl, etc., etc., etc. So she talks a little bit about her soldiers. I think that's an incredibly fun, tongue-in-cheek moment from Erickson, because it works in this conversation between these two people, but also it works from pointing out structuralism. The basic idea there is that, like, as a reader, as a someone who is listening to a story, you assume the structure of whatever you're being told. And so way back from Deadhouse Gates, like, primarily our perspective has been Fiddler. And so the people around Fiddler are the ones we know and care about, right? All the people that are mentioned right there are people that we know, like Cord, Shard, Gessler, Stormy. Like, these are all elements of story and characters that we know and care about. And so the elite group is the group that we, the reader, have been following and know about. But the point of this Corporal Clasp, and I think the point to the reader, is that, like, there's thousands of soldiers, well, I guess now hundreds of soldiers in the Bone Hunters, and none of them are really more important than the others. Even though to us, Fiddler is more important than, you know, Clasp, who we've never met before. That's not true in the real world. These are all just individuals and peoples and characters, all of which are valuable. And we often lose that when we're in the midst of a story because we are attached to the people that we're seeing it from. But I think this is a brilliant tongue-in-cheek moment from Erickson to point out, like, even me, this is Erickson speaking, even me who is, like, trying to not be constrained by structure and the genre as a whole, I can only write so much. And so you as the reader need to realize that there's a lot more going on around. I can only show you so much. I think it's a really cool moment. And again, brilliance from Erickson. The second sort of postmodern reflection is between Lostra and Hinar. And he's reflecting back on the stories that he heard from his maid and how they always had happy endings. He says of the maid, every night she told me how she wanted her life to turn out, though of course I hadn't realized that at the time. But the truth of it was, she wanted that happy ending. She needed to believe in it for her and for everyone else. So I think there's a interesting idea there of the discussion between, should fantasy be escapist or always be escapist, or is it more literary? I think this is a false dichotomy. I think at times it can be both, but I definitely think in a continuum, Malazan falls much more on the literary, challenging side of that continuum than an escapist happy ending. And it's another postmodern reflection on the fact that not all stories need to reflect the happy endings, because often in real life, and that's the point that eventually is made in this discussion, this maid didn't really have a happy ending. Her love, who went off on the sea, never came back. She married someone else and had kids, so she did have a happy ending, but not the happy ending that you would expect in a structured story that we so often have. And so that story in and of itself is a postmodern story. And as the Malazan books as a whole are a postmodern story. So I loved those two elements in the story being reflected back. In a larger sense, the army is continuing through the glass desert, getting closer to the end. The end perspective from Fiddler, I think, is really powerful. He gives sort of an apology for what the series is. Apology in the classic sense, in like a defense of, not like he's apologizing to us, but for the point of the whole thing of being on the side of the crippled god. He's not really fighting for the crippled god, he's fighting for the idea that all of us suffer, all of us are in pain, and the only way to fix that is to be compassionate to one another and help each other through that. And this conflict with the crippled god is just a larger extension of that same basic plea for compassion all around us all the time. And that is ultimately what Erickson wants us to take from the Malazan Book of the Fallen, at least as I read it. Obviously, I'm not Erickson, but that's how I read it, that he wants us to really get that at the center of all of this is that we need to be compassionate to one another, because we are all in pain. We all have our terrible circumstances. And if we take that pain and reflect it and attack the world because of it, we just cause more of that. The answer is compassion. I think it's powerful. Chapter 11 was a great chapter. Excited to see what's next. Please comment in the section below, specifically about those postmodern critiques. Like I said, I'm making a video as soon as I finish the series as a whole, reflecting on that. So any observations you would have or particular moments from other books that you have seen this reflected in, please mention in the comments below. Otherwise, thank you for watching. Like and subscribe. First in, last out.